using Git working directory, I can see that right now my working directory is desktop. I'm going to read a CSV file. And the first row contains information about the variables. So I'm going to say header is true. And we'll call this data file as binary. So we can run this. And you can see binary file has 400 observations and 4 variables. We can look at structure. Using this data, we want to create a predictive model where we want to predict whether or not a student will be admitted to this college. And the variables that help to make this prediction are GRE, GPA, and rank. So I'm going to use nNet. Our variable of interest is admit as a function of tilde and then dot means I want to use all these three variables GRE, GPA, and rank. And our data is binary. So we run this model and we get some solution. Using the model, we want to predict all the values for this data set binary. And let's store these predictions in P. Now we can create a table. And let's store this table in tab. And if you want to look at this tab, this is what we get. In the data set, what we have is given this side. And here you have values based on the prediction. This means 253 students who applied, they were not admitted. And this model also predicts that they are not admitted. But there are 20 students, actually they were not admitted. But the model predicts that they should be admitted. So this is a misclassification. Similarly, there were 98 students who were actually admitted, but the model says they should not be admitted. And 29 were actually admitted. And the model also says or predicts that they should be admitted. So obviously, the correct classification based on this data set is 253 plus 29 divided by the entire data set, which is 400. So let's calculate sum of diagonal values within the tab divided by sum of the entire tab. So this gives us about 0.705. So this is correct classification. And if you do 1 minus, we get 0.295, which is misclassification rate. Now the question is whether this 70% correct classification is good. So let's look at simply how many students were actually admitted and how many students were not admitted. So I'm going to make a quick small table. So you can see in the data set 127 students were admitted and 273 out of 400 were not admitted. One way we can predict whether or not these applicants will be accepted is using the higher value here. So if you see 273 divided by 400. So if we predict all students will not be accepted, still we'll be right 68.25% of the time. If we create a statistical model and find that the percentage of accuracy is less than this number, obviously we should not use that model. So right now we have developed logistic regression model and it gives accuracy of 70.5%. which is slightly better than this. So at least it is better than this benchmark number. So to further do model performance evaluation, let's make use of a package rocr. So let's make a prediction using the model that we developed, my model, and the data set we have is binary, and the type of prediction that we want is probability. So we want to predict probability values and store this in PRED. So now in PRED we have like 400 prediction values. If you want to look at them, you can type PRED. In fact, we can say head PRED So you can see first six probability values are given. If you look at head binary, you can see that first applicant was not admitted and our prediction probability is 0.18, which is very low. So prediction also is that this student should not be admitted. So this is a correct prediction. This classification table that we made, so this makes use of a cutoff which is 0.5. So if the probability is below 0.5, it will say prediction is 0. And if the probability is above 0.5, it will say prediction is 1. So here you can see second probability is 0.3. So prediction will be that student should not be admitted, whereas reality is that this student was admitted. So this is a classification error. Similarly, this is 0.71. So this is more than 0.5. And you can also see that this student was admitted. So this is a correct classification. Now, if you look at the prediction values, so let's make a histogram of PRED. So you can see these probabilities vary between 0 and about 0.8. So this is 0.6. So about 0.8. And most of the values are below 0.4. So if we use 0.5, we may have one type of classification. But if we use cutoff, let's say 0.4 or 0.6, so accuracy or misclassification might change. So let's see what will happen if we do that. And for that, I'm going to make use of prediction function within ROCR. And we'll use these probabilities that we calculated and stored in PRED. And we also make use of the actual values. So let's store this in PRED again. So now we are going to use performance using PRED that we have. And we'll make use of accuracy values. And we'll store this in eval for evaluations. And then let's plot eval. So we get this kind of curve. So what we have is these cutoff values change from 0 to 1. And for different cutoff values, in this picture we see what is the accuracy level that we'll get. So this accuracy is overall accuracy. So you can see when cutoff is close to 0.1, accuracy levels are really very low. In fact, close to 30%. And it rapidly rises as we increase the cutoff values and reaches a peak somewhere here. So remember, 0.5 was our default cutoff. And here we can see what would have been accuracy for different cutoff values. Now, if you want to identify what is the best value here, let's make a line on this chart using AB line. We'll draw a horizontal line at somewhere here, 0.71. So you can see somewhere here we have the peak. And then we try to identify what is this value. So this is about 0.45. So we can say vertical line equals 0.45. So this will give us more or less highest accuracy value for this model. So this is based on our I estimate. We are going to use which dot max, which one is maximum. And the way this ROCR package is made, the data that we have are stored in some slots. So I'm going to make use of a slot. And our data was in eval, and we are interested in y dot values. And then we also specify with double square brackets that this is in 1. And suppose we want to store this in max. So before you run this, if you simply want to look at what exactly is contained in eval, you can just say eval and hit enter. So you'll notice that there are a lot of values that you see. There are y values, there are x values, and so on. So let's run this. So it will identify what is the maximum value. So if you do simply max, so what is there in max? So it says that it is the 61st value. Now let's go into the slot for eval. and we are interested in y values, and double square brackets, and then one more square bracket, and we specify this is for the max that we identified in the last row, and let's store this accuracy value in ACC. So now ACC has that value. Let's look at what is contained in ACC. So this is 0.7175. So the highest value here is 0.7175. And now we want to figure out what is the optimal cutoff level for that 0.7175 value. So it may not be exactly 0.45 that we have seen here. It may be slightly different. So we are going to make use of the same format. So from using slot and eval, now we want values on the x-axis, so x dot values, and square brackets two times with one in it, and we also specify that against the maximum, and let's call this as cut for cutoff. So if you want to look at how much is the cutoff, you can see this is 0.468, so not exactly 0.45 that we were looking at on the graph. So now we can print. So if you run this, it will give us what is the accuracy value and what is the cutoff value. So when compared to a default cutoff value of 0.5 that we have here, a cutoff value of 0.4683, so this will give us a better accuracy of 0.7175. Remember, this is based on the table that we have seen earlier. So this table was just for one situation where cutoff is 0.5, and it tells us how the model has performed. But sometimes what can happen is, instead of focusing on the overall accuracy or misclassification, we are more concerned about predicting more accurately in one group compared to the other group. For example, if we have data on bankruptcies and we are trying to make a prediction whether a company will go bankrupt, represented by 1, in that case, our interest may lie more in correctly predicting 1 rather than 0. So that's where we can make use of ROC curve. We'll make use of performance, and we'll calculate TPR, true positive rate. So true positive rate based on this data is 29 divided by 29 plus 98. True positive rate is about 22%. Obviously, this is a very, very low accuracy level for correctly predicting 1. Most of the times 1 is being misclassified as 0. So obviously this one needs big improvement. When we look at the overall model and see that accuracy is 71.75, that looks very good. But when we have to focus on 1, accuracy level of 22% obviously is not very good. Similarly, we also calculate what is called false positive rate. So false positive rate, we can calculate again from the same table here. So for example, 20 is falsely predicted as 1 out of 20 plus 253. So false prediction rate in this case will be 20 divided by 253 plus 20. So false prediction rate is about 7%. We can do this calculation and store this in, let's say, ROC, because we are going to make a ROC curve. So remember, these calculations are based on a cutoff value of 0.5, which is default. But when we do ROC curve, we'll also be able to see how is the performance for different cutoff values. So that's the idea. We got this one. Now let's plot ROC. So you can see this is how the ROC curve looks like. So you have true positive rate on the y-axis, and we have false positive rate on the x-axis. So the ideal situation should be that the curve starts somewhere here at 0, 0 and goes to this one, 0, 1, and then this value, which is 1, 1. And that would have classified in a perfect way, or accuracy would have been 100%. But in reality, based on the data, we get these curves which are not really close to the ideal value. We can draw a line in the middle so that the intercept is 0 and slope B is 1. So this straight line here means without any model, if we say that out of 400 students reject everyone, we will be right about 68% of the time. So if the model does worse than that, so this curve will be below the line. But obviously in this case, the model is doing better. So this curve can be compared for different models, and we can see which model is doing better and which model is not doing good. We can customize this chart by adding few more things. We can colorize by saying true. So if you run that line, you'll see now there's a color, and that color is based on the cutoff. So for example, 0.5 is somewhere here. So that light green color is for cutoff at 0.5. So cutoff values range from 0.05 up to 0.72 in this example. We can also add a title. Note that Y label here is true positive rate. Another name for this is sensitivity. Also, X label, we can say this is 1 minus specificity. So that's another name for false positive rate. So if you run that, you get this title here, sensitivity and 1 minus specificity. And of course, we can draw this AB line and see how the model performs against this benchmark. Another way people use this ROC curve is to calculate area under the curve, because visually we can see that this curve is doing better than the benchmark. But when you have many curves on this chart, what will happen is it will be difficult to differentiate between the performances. So we need a numeric value. What we do is we find area under the curve, and if the area is higher, that means model performance is better. So note that for the entire rectangle here, the total area is 1. And if you look at this line, area below this line will be 50%. Obviously, area under the curve for the model that we have built, that area will be more than 50%. So let's see how much we get. So we'll use performance, PRED, that we have calculated earlier. We'll get AUC, area under curve. And let's store this in AUC. So we'll make use of this command here, unlist and slot AUC that we calculated earlier, Y dot values. So let's store this also in AUC. So if you simply run AUC, so you can see we get 0.6921, etc. But if you want to round this to less number of decimals, you can do AUC, and let's say we'll have only 4. So now you see only 4 decimal values. So let's add this number to this graph somewhere here using legend. Let's say we want the legend to start somewhere at 0.6 and 0.2. So X value is 0.6, Y value is 0.2. We want AUC. We can also give a title. Now you can see area under the curve is indicated on this graph. You can also choose to change the size of this by using CEX. If you say 4, it will be very big. So obviously this will not fit. 1.2. So let me run this line again and this one again. So this is with about 1.2 size.